I went to a friend's house. He was looking a little sad, so I asked him, what's the problem? And he said, it's Father's Day, and all my friends are wishing their fathers happy Father's Day on Facebook, and my dad is not on Facebook. What can I do? So I said, your dad's in the next room. Why don't you go and wish him there? And he said, what an idea, Sergi. And he, you know, do that. Social media, what is it doing to us? What is it doing to society? Recently, there have been a few interviews by ex-executives of Facebook, very senior people, and they've created some ripples. One of them was Chamath Palihapitiya. He was the vice president of user growth, and he said that he regrets having tools that are ripping apart the social fabric of how society works. And, you know, he creates a scenario where he says there's going to be no civil discourse, no cooperation. There's going to be mistruth, misinformation. Sean Parker, first president of Facebook, he says it literally changes your relationship with society. And he also says that God alone knows what it's doing to our children's brains. Scary things, you know, coming from people like them. One important thing that Chamath Palihapitiya also said was that he is very much against these short-term dopamine-driven feedback loops. Now, what are these short-term dopamine-driven feedback loops? You post a picture or a, you know, any kind of a post on Facebook, people like it and comment on it, and it releases a little chemical in your brain called dopamine, which is giving you pleasure. This is scientifically, this is what happens. But it's short-term. It goes away and then you feel empty again and you feel shallow. So what do? You do this again. You put something else, another selfie with a pout. He's laughing a lot. Men also pout. I've seen men do that. You put a picture of your baby because you want more people to, again, you know, like. So you go into this feedback loop. It creates a kind of an addiction. It reminds me of a story that I heard about somebody in America. I don't know if it's true, but there was this family which is coming back from a vacation, and the neighbor was outside in her garden, and she saw them coming and said, hey, you're back from your vacation. How was it? And they said, we don't know yet. We haven't uploaded the pictures. So these feedback loops are asking for social validation. I don't know, is it really this monster that people are making social media out to be? You know, is it going to control our minds? Are we being programmed? I really don't know the answer to this. Maybe these people are pointing to a scenario that can happen. And I think that can happen if we use it, if we use social media in a passive manner, like we consume television. It's one way. Internet, social media can be two way. So you have to get ahead and use it well. And I think I've done that. I've been using social media as a tool for building communities. And that's what I'm going to talk to you about. The idea is you meet in the virtual world, but then you go out and meet in the real world. So flesh and blood meetings. And as a result of which, a lot of beautiful communities have been created and a lot of friendships, deep lasting friendships for me. And how did I do that? To go on the journey, let me rewind a little back to just the pre-Facebook days, 2000, 2001, 2002, I don't remember. We were a group of filmmakers. I'm a filmmaker as well. And a bunch of filmmakers, we were attending some film festivals. And we felt, you know, it's great that we get to see all this world cinema. That's the only place for independent filmmakers also to show their work at that time. But the only thing is this atmosphere is very oppressive. You know, you have this auditorium and you have this red carpet and all these speeches and bouquets and ministers coming, and you have to dress in a certain way and you have to behave in a certain way. Independent filmmakers don't always like to behave in a certain way. So we thought, let's have our own festival, which will be our kind of festival, where if I want to go in shorts, chappals, and I want to lie down on a chatai and watch a film and talk about it with you, about your film, let's have an Adda kind of a festival. So we zeroed in on a name. We called it Buy-Off, Bring Your Own Film Festival, BYOFF. Just like you have those parties, you know, bring your own booze, party ho jayegi. So bring your own film festival ho jayega. And we went to Puri in India, the eastern coast of India. We found a beautiful hotel called Hotel Pink House, small place right next to the sea. And the owners were wonderful and they said, you come and do it here. So with a friend, Sushant Mishra, a filmmaker from Odisha, along with him and many other people, we created our own film festival over there. The important things in that were no hierarchy, no bureaucracy, no awards, and most important, no selection. You know, for independent filmmakers, this idea ke yaar meri film select hogi festival mein, I'm biting my nails, oh, will they find it good enough? That's the only forum to show your films at that time. And we wanted to get away, imagine breaking these shackles and, you know, getting away from this oppression. No selection. If you think you've made a great film, bring it and show it. Choose your own time slot, first come, first served. It was like that, by the seaside. Great idea. That was before Facebook and social media. Internet had started, of course. Email was there. We put up posters and all, and I wrote an email describing, this is the place, Hotel Pink House, half buried in sand, the sea is here, we'll bring your own chatais, bring your own chappals, bring your films, we'll have, you know. So I sent an email, and it spread. And I thought about 20-25 filmmakers will land up, and we'll, you know, roam around during the day, have street food, go to the sea, and in the evening, sundown, we'll start watching films. But what happened was, the responses started coming in. I'm coming, I've got this film, I'm bringing it. Wow, what an idea. And we decided that now we'll have to accommodate more people. The idea was open, everybody's welcome. So we said, okay, we'll have a tent and we'll start screenings during the afternoon. Then we said, oh, too many more people are coming, let's have two tents. So we'll start screenings in the afternoon, that's the only way we can accommodate them. Eventually we had three screens, instead of 3 days, we made it 5 days. 250 filmmakers landed up. I don't know how we did it, but we did it. We had no idea where the money is coming from, but you know, the idea was never to say no to anyone. And what a festival it was. It became like a small movement in a way. Now, we are not professional event organizers, we are filmmakers. So next year we tried to scale it down. We can't do something so big. But the community kept growing. And after about 5 or 6 years, when internet and social media came in a big way, that became another platform to show independent films. So, you know, I'm a filmmaker, meri bhadas hai ki log meri film dekhe. I'll put it on the net, at least 500 people will see it, 6,000 people will see it. And small festivals started coming up in other parts of the country, which was not the case earlier. So I knew ki now this idea is going to last for another 3, 4, 5 years, 6 years. After that, it'll start going down. So now let me go back to my original idea and let me do that small festival I was thinking about. I thought that's very important. It's very important to do small events, small gatherings. And I said, we'll have that small film festival, which I thought ke hoga. At the same time, I realized, a thought came to my mind, why only films? You know, why only for filmmakers? Let's make this gathering a little more broad-based, because we independent filmmakers have a problem. We fight a lot. That's not the problem. Fighting is okay. We fight over the same thing. Over and over again. We are stuck in the same loop. Every year we would have the same arguments. So I said, we must meet others. We must meet musicians. We must meet poets. We must meet architects. Learn from each other. This was the time Facebook had started and communities were building. And we used Facebook. Another friend of mine, Sukant Panigrahi, along with him, I started a group called Mafia. M-A-F-I-A. It stands for Musicians, Artists, Filmmakers, Interesting Log, Ajao. No, I'm not joking. It's there, you can, it's there on Facebook. You can check it. He's taken out his phone, he's going to become a member right away. Yeah? You can do it later. But it's there, Mafia. And we did a gathering. The idea of this gathering was 15 to 20 people. Whoever signs up first, we don't know who's coming. But this is the idea. Let's meet in an open space, away from the city. We'll spend 3 days next to a river or maybe in the mountains. A lot of friends who owned small resorts or places there gave this. Arey, what a great idea. Chalo mere haan karo. No profit, no loss basis. Cost pe deta hun. And we started Mafia. And the first one was something truly magical. I don't know. I didn't know what was magical, but we all knew something was happening. So we did another and we did another. And first year we did 12, probably one a month. Mafia gatherings led on to a lot of other things. These small addas of people without an agenda. You land up, then we'll decide what to do. We'll do origami together. Somebody will sing a song. Somebody will take us for bird watching. Somebody will do whatever, you know. And we'll have a learning exchange. But with no agenda, with no commercial interest. It's jamming. Let's get together. Let's share. Let's share ideas and thoughts and experiences. And I realized after a while that it was doing something really great to the people who were attending it. They made me realize, they said, it's more than just an adda. It's changed my life. Somebody said this, somebody said that. It's only space where I get where, you know, nobody's judging me. I want to learn singing, I'm singing badly, nobody's going to laugh at me. I stumble and fall, nobody's laughing at me. They're helping me, they're cheering me on. They're saying, okay, come on, do it this way. There's a space where nobody's judging me. I can be myself. That is the kind of a space where, you know, we wanted to operate in, and that is what happened. This idea that addas are very important was deeply ingrained in my mind. And probably from my film institute days. I was in the film institute in Pune, FTII Pune. Over there we have a big adda, it's called the wisdom tree. Bodhi Vriksh. You sit under this tree and you get wisdom. It's a mango tree, mangoes to aate nahi, but wisdom aata hai. On this side is the main theater where films are screened. In a film school, that's like a temple, that's like a classroom. And on this side was the canteen, and in the middle was the wisdom tree. Go and watch a film, pick up a chai, come sit there, have an adda, have a discussion, talk about the film. Fight if you want to, but talk. Have conversations. Sometimes seniors would come who have passed out. They would bring their experiences of having worked in the real world. I stopped attending classes. I was lying under the wisdom tree most of the time. Teachers started conducting classes there. Well, even before my time, teachers have been conducting classes here. Every creative institute needs an adda. Because that adda is the place where most of your knowledge comes. This might be a good time to go a little more deep into the idea of what is an adda. And when you want to go deep, what do? Google. So let's Google, let's go to Wikipedia. Wikipedia, of course, the first thing it says, Bengal se aaya hai. It's from Bengal, you can see. Which is true. There are many meanings to the word adda. But the one that I'm talking about is the closest to the meaning of the word in Bengal, the adda of Bengal, where people meet at a coffee shop or meet at a wherever and have conversations. It says over here, intellectuals meet. No, I'm not very sure if all of us were intellectuals, but anyway, we wanted to meet and have conversations. In fact, in this Wikipedia page, you'll see Satyajit Ray in his film Agantuk says that, you know, he traces it back to the time of Socrates and Plato. Dekha? I can sense people are saying, wow, Socrates, Plato, haan, is baat mein to kuch vajan hai. Pehle pata nahi kya bol raha tha, aa jao, adda, mafia. But yes, Satyajit Ray saab ne bhi bola hai. So it must be something great. And it is, I think. And other meanings are also there. It says in Hindi, if you go scroll further in Wikipedia, in Hindi it says, shady people. Wikipedia is not always right, you don't need to believe it. Oxford English Dictionary brought it into their dictionary in 2004. They say, amongst other things, it's an illicit place for where you get place where you get illicit liquor. It's, I mean, liquor is okay, but illicit nahi hona chahiye. But it says, you know, adda is a place for people to meet, and it also says adda is a place where people embark for journeys, which is true. Hawaii adda, bus adda. But when you talk, I talk to a lot of people in addas about adda, and I also learned that adda is derived from the, you know, there is a perch, a nesting place, that is also an adda. A loom where you weave is also an adda. So whether it's a nesting place where you come at the end of the day and you share things, whether it's a temporary space where you meet for a while and then embark on your respective journeys, or whether it's a loom where you weave stories, whatever it is, adda is there in us. I would go even further back than Socrates and Plato. Right from time immemorial, maybe when man was hunter-gatherer, even before you know, cultivation, what would he do? He would go out during the day, come back, around the bonfire, he would share stories, you know. Oh, today there was this lion and this is how I escaped. Or the other guy would say, you know, I found a new fruit. I think I'm going to call it banana. The monkeys love it. Oh, no, I've found this new aerodynamic, you know, design for this arrow. And this arrow can kill that antelope. I don't know whether they use this language. Maybe they didn't use language. Maybe they enacted it out. It even predates language. But it was an adda. around a bonfire, which is where learning happened. Adda is in our DNA. In Bengal, it was in coffee shops, in tea shops, of course. Bengali tea shops, tea shop addas are very important in Bengal. They led to a lot of revolutions there. Addas can lead to civilizations, they can lead to revolutions. So addas, I think not just for human beings, but even for animals. There is a bunch of crows which comes near my house and they have an adda every day. And they talk, talk all the time. I'm sure they're doing a lot of learning exchange. That's why we say crow is a very intelligent bird. I think now people will realize that, something that we take lightly, adda bazi, is really something very important. And this adda quality of mafia that we used to have in mafia helped us to create a lot of other things. And all through Facebook, all through social media. We started Food Friends and Folk Music, where we would invite rural musicians to come and perform for urban audiences. Because in urban areas, it's all diluted through films, the folk music. And out there, people are leaving their music and they are taking up other jobs like taxi driving, or they want to become farmers because they don't have the money to continue singing. So we started a community of folk music lovers where people would just put in money and meet and enjoy this folk music together and have a dinner after that. We started screenings at my home. Mere ghar aajo, 6 people, 8 people, open. Anybody, put it on Facebook. Watching a film alone on your laptop or your iPad or your tablet is very different from watching a film with 6 people or 8 people. And if the filmmaker is present, it's even greater. It's even better, that experience. You have a discussion after that. We started Visual Arts Wala Adda. There's another friend called Nihal. He got inspired. He's a poet. He put it on Facebook one day at such and such place in Hoskas near that monument. All those who want to recite their poetry come. About 24 beautiful poets landed up. What beautiful poetry it was. And it started a lovely community, a meet of the poets. He started Chai Coffee Baatcheet. The essential adda. Let's call a man who has something or a woman who has something wonderful to share. Call and talk. And let's listen to them. He started Kitab Exchange. You've got old books at home, don't give them to the Raddiwala, bring them. I'll bring mine, you take mine, I'll take yours. So at least 20, 25 people would land up and do a Kitab, book lovers. Lots and lots of communities came up. And for me, the best thing that came out of it were, we started doing festivals. In one of the mafias we did was in a place called Sona Pani in Uttarakhand. Wonderful couple that runs it, very warm-hearted people. And they said, come and do a film festival here. So we started doing film festival, we do food festival. We invite 3 people, 3 filmmakers, and they are sharing their work with you spread over 3 days. So you're having lunch, breakfast, dinner together with them, you're sitting around the bonfire with them. There's a different kind of bonding that's taking place between filmmakers and audience. Adda, it is really something in between a festival and an adda, and for me, these were wonderful. And people told me, because I attended that mafia, I made my second film, otherwise I was very disillusioned after my first film. Another one said, because of that mafia which I attended, my band got formed. There's a musician who was here at TEDx, Harpreet, very talented guy, and he said that it's only because of the mafia gatherings that I came out of my shell and I started performing and I got the confidence. iTokri, there's a website on handicrafts, beautiful, it came out of mafia gatherings. Lots and lots and lots and lots of things came out of it without any agenda. And for me, the most important thing that came out of it was these deep, lasting friendships. As you grow older, you start making less and less friends. But for me, as I'm growing older, through these communities, I'm making very wonderful friends. We took a line from Yeats, the poet. There are no strangers here, only friends you haven't met yet. So please have addas. Because addas give birth to wonderful ideas which are worth sharing, which you can share from such beautiful platforms. Please have addas. Please meet those strangers who you think are strangers, but they are your friends. Thank you.